we both played Sonic 2. We played it a lot. We played a lot of Sonic 2.
This week on Backward Compatible, Jim, Doc, Chris, and Eric discuss why people don't finish games and what that means for game design and discourse. Plus, Detroit Become Human, the future of the Yakuza franchise, and more. The BackwardCompatible.com podcast starts right now.
Hello, Backward Compatible listeners. Welcome to episode 130 of the Backward-Compatible.com podcast. Games and new media with a splash of academia. I'm Chris, and I'm joined today by Jim.
Hey, everybody.
And we're joined by Doc.
Hey, everybody.
And we're joined by Eric.
Hello again.
And today we're talking about what should be quite a lively discussion. It's in completing a game. So we've talked before about the differences between, you know, finishing a game and completing a game. What does that mean? And what's the difference between those? And today we're going to be talking a little bit about why it is that we stop playing games or simply fail to come back to a game. And then what that means from a criticism perspective, as far as people having an opinion on the games, that sort of thing.
And so, if the pre-show discussion is any indication, there will be shouting and punching and possibly some blood.
And does it count if when I incomplete a game, if I snap the disc in half out of frustration? Is that okay?
That's a personal
problem.
I
expect that you do that after you finish a game too.
Only if the controller is
as a sign of dominance. You're like, snap.
Kind of a Napoleon-esque kind of like burn the ships kind of.
100%.
Nothing more can be done with this game.
DLC? No!
But first, we have some opening segments for you, including the Button Mosh.
Get ready for the Button Mosh, where the crew jumps in on the video games they've been rocking lately.
So just the other day, I started playing Detroit Become Human. I know Doc and Eric, you guys both played the demo.
The demo. Yes.
Which is actually the first sequence in the game. So I got to kind of experience what you guys were talking about first thing. And so like that was kind of a cool experience.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's funny, too, because as soon as I brought this up, like, the first thing that Jim said is like, oh, yeah, I heard that they got, like, really trite story, and then, Doc, you agreed. I don't know. I could see how people could look at this and say that this is a very sort of generic cyberpunk kind of thing, mm-hmm. kind of your sort of typical androids and humans relationships sort of stuff.
Well, they didn't even, like, conjugate the grammar correctly in the title. Detroit Become Human? Come on.
It's Detroit colon Become Human. You're becoming human
in
Detroit.
Is that what human is to have a colon?
Yes.
Stay away from my colon.
Actually, the androids don't eat, so I mean, there you go.
Wow, this just got deep.
I think that...
really, really petty. I'm not sure which.
I can see how there'd be a lot of people who didn't like Heavy Rain for your kind of typical reasons of it's not a game, it's a quick time event.
Yeah.
But if you're willing to move past that, I actually think that they've learned quite a bit in this game. I'm liking the different decision points you have. The game feels to me a little bit smarter about like you actually have to do a lot more thinking and kind of observation and puzzle solving.
They hand that to you too. I mean, they've got that whole flow chart that they give you at the end of the mission. And it's like, here's what you did. Here are the other things you could do.
And yet it actually, at least from what I saw in the demo, it keeps all of those other things blanked out.
It does.
Unless you actually did
it's
it
not
in
overt,
a different playthrough.
You can infer, though, because if it's like, you know, shot your gun, and then there's a blank, it's like, okay, so that's obviously didn't shoot my gun.
Yeah.
You know, or lied. Okay, so this is obviously did not lie.
But when there's 9 potential endings to a mission,
that's a little trickier. Yeah, that's true. Yeah. Well, the demo has 6.
Yeah.
I played it through and got all 6. And I got to say, there was one that was very difficult to force myself to do, and it's the one where the little girl dies. Mm. I had to literally just do nothing that she would die. And I was like, ugh.
That's
I felt kind of dirty about that. But the problem is I felt tricked. After I got all 6 endings, I felt completely betrayed because the ending I was going for, and this is a spoiler, by the way, but the ending I was going
for the
was the one for the demo, was the one where, because it's a hostage situation, I wanted everyone to live. I wanted the android who's gone bonkers to live. I wanted myself to live, who is also an android, and I wanted the little girl to live, obviously. And that there's no option for that. Out of six endings, there isn't one.
I can see that, but at the same time, like the ending where the android dies every time, that's kind of the point of this game. That's part of the story that's kind of essential to the premise around.
It's the setup for the plot hook. But here's the problem.
Not just the plot hook. It's the entire society. Like the whole game is about how androids are treated.
Okay, well, I'm speaking of it in narrative terms. You're speaking of it in setting terms. We're both right. But here's my issue, okay? We are almost, and I mean almost, at a point where we can tell these open-ended adaptive narratives that are going to really adapt to what I want to happen in a story. Mm-hmm. And we come back to that essential problem that we always come back to, which is that the average person can't tell a good story. They think they can, but they can't. And so what you need is a GM-like, let's call it intelligence, whether that be a designer or a writer from the beginning who limits the choices to six, or something which is going to keep you from just going completely off the rails. You know what I'm saying here? So we're still not there yet. And by handing me the flowchart and looking at all the possibilities, it seemed to imply to me that there was a range, but at the end, ultimately, there is not a range. There isn't. There is the story they're trying to tell. And so the idea of having choices is functionally limited to the point of not really actually mattering.
I disagree with that from what I've played.
You've
so
played
far.
More, so yeah. You can.
I'm sure there's still, I look at it like Telltale. They're trying to tell a particular story. So there's a lot of stuff that is going to happen a particular way. However, there are lots of places where you get to choose how you react to things or how you approach things.
Uh-huh.
And from just like kind of a pure gameplay perspective, I just finished playing a level where you're trying to escape a manor and someone's chasing you down. Mm-hmm. And in the lead up to this, you get to sort of like see the manor and kind of experience, like you try to like sort of grok the layout, and there's a time pressure. Mm-hmm. There are a lot of places in this game where there's a time pressure that's actually meaningful and really cool. And I was sort of looking around this house, and when the chase finally happened, you have a choice of do I go left or go right? I remembered that door was locked. I need to go right. That sort of thing. Yeah. Where you can actually see, and this is in like less of a narrative sense, but more of a like danger sense, mm-hmm. of I can see places where my remembering something as a player is saving me right now.
Uh-huh.
And that was something that's really cool. So even if you're not talking about the broader narrative, I think that they're doing a really good job with moment to moment, making the interactions, making the choices meaningful.
That's interesting because see, I actually felt pushed the other direction by it.
In the demo doesn't have a lot of that.
Okay. But you're saying that the main game does?
Yes. That's something too, where my opinion on it might change a little bit on replay.
Mm-hmm.
There are a few places where I'm curious to see, because I'm sure there are some branches that don't mean much.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
I think there are some branches that will mean a lot. And yeah. So I'm really curious to see which ones do and which ones don't at what points.
That makes sense.
But that being said, as I'm going through it, I do feel like there's a really tangible sense of my decisions are mattering, even if it's an illusion. And I'm really enjoying the story so far. I think that it's generic cyberpunk in a sense, but it is very pertinent to, I think, our current political climate and our current sort of technological outlook.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that as far as kind of like looking at our future, and they actually even say like at the beginning of the game, like this isn't just a story, it's our future, which is like, oh boy, you know, how fancy.
That's
of you.
So profound.
but it's kind of true. They were basing everything on kind of like what some futurists looking at us now might see happening. And there's a lot of kind of metaphorical political commentary happening.
Machio
as well.
Cuckoo wasn't mentioned, was he?
Not directly.
Okay. Yeah.
So even if it is generic, it's very well executed for what it is. I like the three different characters you play. There's the detective character we saw in the demo in the first scene.
Yeah.
And then you end up kind of going down a Viva la Resistance route, and you also go down a fugitive on the run route. And so you kind of get these three like kind of archetypal stories in this genre, and they're all done really well, in my opinion. So I'm loving the game so far.
This is the Gaming Meta. News and commentary about the games industry and gamer culture.
So I've recently completed Yakuza 6, The Song of Life. And I have to say, I was very impressed. It's a game that had an excellent storyline. And one of the best parts about the game is actually how they managed to weave all of these plot twists and sort of play with your expectations for how the story is going to go. Essentially, it's kind of the swan song for Kiru Kazuma, who is the main character. He's the former Yakuza who kind of becomes this anti-hero throughout all of the games. And in this one, they take a really bold stance. And that's kind of what I wanted to talk about the future of the series, because we're at a point where Yakuza, even though it started on the PS2 in 2005, and we've gotten a lot of those games, they have come to America. They haven't really been that popular. They've been pretty niche titles. And the series has experienced this boom in the West lately, beginning with Yakuza 0, which got a lot of attention, and then carrying over into Yakuza Kiwami, which is a remake for the original game coming out in 2005. So where does the series go from here? Because they just, with Yakuza 6, released essentially the last game in the series. And what they did with Yakuza 6, I think, was brilliant and on purpose. Instead of relying on this cast of characters they had built up for five games that were beloved by fans of the series, like Majima or Daigo or Tajima, they instead used almost an entirely new cast, introduced an entirely new cast of characters, most of whom are young enough that they could potentially carry over into a sequel if they wanted to do so. They also retired Kiryu in a way that was both respectful and didn't really annoy the fans. Like, he kind of does that. It's very similar to a Western, like the sort of walking off into the sunset feeling. I don't want to get too much into spoilers, but there's
Shane, come back, Shane.
he actually literally walks into the sunset.
He kind of does, yeah. But it is a spoiler in the sense that if people are really expecting him to die, they kind of do this, is he going to die? I mean, there's this moment at the end, and I talked about this somewhat on a couple episodes ago about just how effective they are at telling the story. And of how effective they are at making you want to fight after these cutscenes, you know, these very dramatic cutscenes. And some of the methods that they use, particularly in the last fight, your daughter, and this is just, you know, minor spoilers about some of the way this goes down. I won't go into the big spoiler about the secret of Onomichi and all of that. I'll save that for the show. I will say it goes into the depths of Japanese history, by the way. So if you're a history buff, particularly of Japanese history, there's a lot there. But one of the things they do, and at this final scene, is they've essentially, after they kill, they flat out kill some of the characters, by the way, that you think are going to be carrying on into this next series. So they take you into, essentially, they kidnap, or you go to, like, end everything. You're going to, like, one of the main character girls or women that they introduced has been killed, and you're going to go to essentially this big Yakuza boss who's, you've revealed him as the big bad guy, and you're going to go take him down. And he's the son of this, essentially, of the main character who kind of turns on his father, and he ends up being, he looks like this like nerdy guy, but really he takes his shirt off and he's like super jacked, and he's been working out, and he's been secretly this Yakuza badass, and no one knew about it. You know, he's like real shrewd. And so you're going to hunt him down, right? And you get there and you find out that your daughter has been kidnapped too. And now you have to just accept it. And like, he's beating on you. You can't fight back or they'll kill her. And then your team shows. And like, this whole time you're like, I just want to rip this guy apart. Mm-hmm. He's been behind everything. I want to rip him apart. And they build it up. And this, and like, to the point where you're just boiling mad. And then they give you control back. And at that point, it just becomes this like visceral experience as you're fighting. It's like, there's no way you're going to lose because you're just so, you have this like pent up, like, I'm ready to destroy this person. And of course, as part of that, you have to do, you know, you have the whole sacrifice. You think Kiryu's dead for a while, then he's not dead, then he's dead again. You know, of course they go this back and forth. Of course they can't kill him off.
He's zombie just, Kiryu.
Yeah, they can't kill him off. He's just too...
That would be a good spinoff.
Yeah, right. But yeah, no, they can't do it because I feel it would have been too much of backlash from fans, and I get that. But they retire him, essentially. Everyone thinks he's dead at the end. Now, they could reverse this if they wanted to, but I feel it's a great way to retire the character and essentially have him live on in people's memories for this future cast that they introduced without actually killing him off. Like, you know he's out there. You have that he rode off into the sunset kind of feel. And because of that, it brings the series or allows the series to stay relevant as they tell more of his story that some people hadn't played in the West, because they are going to release a Kiwami, which is essentially a remake of the second through fifth games here in the West too. Those are coming very soon. Not very soon, but they are coming in the next few years for the PS4.
Believe it or not, we're not always playing games. Every now and then, we like to talk about the other stuff.
All right, I want to talk about The Expanse. Specifically the show, though, I have to say, I can't say enough good things about the books. Now, I listen to them as an audiobook, and they're brilliantly read as an audiobook.
For those that aren't aware, this is a science fiction
show, right? It is science fiction. I would call it hard sci-fi until a point.
Okay.
And when the world is being established, it's very much established as a hard sci-fi. What I'm talking about here is The Expanse, the TV show. And a lot of stuff is sort of abstracted out in the TV show, like the gravity. It's just kind of given. There's gravity boots. Just don't worry about why their hair is laying down, okay? And that kind of a thing. And so to me, I really want to talk about it from a transmedia standpoint in terms of the media form as it is. So whenever you think of like the show as it currently is at the time of recording, they just did a soft reboot. And it's because it's between books. It's literally the point where one book ends and another book begins. And it's season 3. And at the time of recording, it's episode 7 has just aired. And you've gotten to the moment, which everyone who's read the book would recognize as being the we need to talk moment. So I'm not going to spoil that beyond what that is, except to say that that line doesn't come out. It's a different line that fits, I'd say, really well for the show because it's something that was said in the show. And so it gives the same emotional impact and the same character and all of that. That said, overall, I think that episode, episode 7, encapsulates well why I love the academic study of transmedia, or if you prefer, cross-media, and the worlds that go with them. In other words, adaptation. Right. I used to teach a class on it. I called it Transmedia Worlds when I taught it. And all we did was we compared books to comics to films to shows and all of that. And it was that study of why adaptation is important. So I felt like the changes were profound, but it really spoiled nothing by reading ahead, if you will. Rather, I was kind of delighted as the things in my head were brought to screen. Slightly different than I knew them, but with the delicious and necessary changes for an episodic television media format, mostly with new, like certain characters being shifted into the main characters, so we can't keep more than about the 12 or 15 characters that we know in there at all times.
Smart adaptation. Like I've heard a lot of people.
Smart adaptation is a good way to say it.
Talk a lot about how they actually like the differences between, say, Game of Thrones, the books, and Game of Thrones, the show. Mm-hmm. And how at some point they start to like deviate a little bit, but both in their own kind of interesting
yes.
ways.
Yeah. Great example, actually. Yeah.
And people have said the same thing about Walking Dead.
Walking Dead. Okay. So all that said, it's absolutely time for a rethink and a rehaul of the Nielsen ratings, because the Nielsen ratings almost single-handedly killed this awesome show. Yep. And here's why. Those ratings only count those who watch it live.
Yeah.
And Sci-Fi Channel.
And in New York.
Oh, there you go. And Sci-Fi Channel was not able to renew the show. Well, let's put it that way. I'll give them credit for what really happened there. Was not able to renew the show based on the money they were making and the ratings that were being shown. Mm-hmm. It's a completely inaccurate depiction of how popular the show is, because most of us, myself included, stream it, second screen it, binge it, never watch it live. Right. Yep. I mean, I pay directly for it. So I actually pay through Prime to watch the thing at my leisure. And usually that's the next day when it comes out. And then I will rewatch the entire season over again. I have probably never watched a show as many times as I have watched this one.
Really?
Yeah. To the level of almost having it memorized in terms of beats. And that's because there's so much going on in the background and so much just wonderful deliciousness that I want to consume it over and over again, like a miniseries. Because frankly, that's what we're on now. Whenever we do 8 episodes and we call it a season, you know, that's kind of
really
the British model. It's a
miniseries
in many ways. So, you know, thank you, Sci-Fi Network, for rescuing Stargate One, Stargate SG-1 and Mystery Science Theater a decade ago. But your time is done. You need to change your model. Amazon Prime is now rescuing the good shows from you. We need to overhaul the Nielsens. We need to overhaul how we're doing this. And we need to update for the 21st century so that we don't have to suffer through the trash that cable subscribers, and I say that with derision because I'm not one, are forcing the ratings into a certain direction. Yeah. Let's get with the reality.
Need to overhaul the cable model entirely.
Exactly. And if you have not seen The Expanse, go get it. It's not for kids. There's quite a bit of adult content, but not on the level of Thrones, shall we say. So there you go.
It's time for War Stories, tales of tribulation and triumph in gaming.
So, a few episodes ago, we talked about trophies and completing games and completing trophy lists and achievements and things like that. And I think that one of the things that I alluded to was, especially some of the podcasts that I listened to, I've kind of gotten an interest in kind of certain reasons for why you may want to finish a trophy list or get the, like on PlayStation consoles, like get the platinum achievement. And one of those reasons was because, like, I like the idea, if I love a game enough, I almost kind of want to give, like, that particular creator, like, a thank you, or, like, kind of show, like, how much I love this particular game, right? And so I've actually had a couple over the past year or so that I've been wanting to do, and I've been putting on the bookshelf because I had my own game coming out. Mm-hmm. And so back in January, my company, we shipped a game called Innerspace. We've talked about it a couple times on the podcast before. And I played it on and off. You know, I mean, I played it plenty during development. Yeah, so course. It's like, I need a little bit of time away anyway. And so last week or so, either last week or the week before, I finally popped the Platinum Trophy on my own game. And one of the cool elements of that was, and kind of where it, I think the war story comes is, on one hand, it was actually my first platinum that I've ever done.
That's really kind of funny.
Yeah, right. And so it was like, yeah. And so I kind of manufactured that a little bit. I could have platinumed a few other games within the past year, but decided not to for that. But I actually struggled with it a little bit because Innerspace has a collectathon element to it. It's very exploratory, and then there's a lot of collectibles in the game. And we happened to move those collectibles around enough throughout development, and some of those were moved right around towards like the very finalization of the game, to the point that I actually, when they had been placed and I hadn't done a full completion in a very long time, months and months before the game actually launched, I couldn't remember where they were. And so I actually, two kind of funny things ended up happening is, on one of the elements that we really wanted to have in the game that we had actually talked about, because we'd come up with an idea of how we could possibly do a map for the world in game. And if you've played the game, you know, despite it being an exploratory game, there's not an in-game map. And part of that is because we found it near impossible to do an inside out world to actually have a map that would actually represent that well. Hmm. And one of the things that we talked about that would be really cool is if we could actually have just simply a key command that allowed you to actually literally connect to your printer and print out a map of the world, and then allow you to actually do your own archiving and actually like kind of track, okay, I got this one here, I got this one here. Hmm. For players that might find that cool, we ended up not getting that feature in. I actually ended up having to do that myself because there's a thing in one of the worlds I knew was somewhere there, and I actually had to start mapping, and like it must have looked like just this scribbling of just an insane person of like, I had this whole world mapped out on paper. It's like, okay, I know I got this. Where is this other one? Where did this person put it? And I'm almost like calling like my coworkers to say like, where do you put this one? And then it hit me. No, I have a way to actually do this. So I Googled for my own game, the trophy guide. And so long story short, after a lot of trial and error and finally figuring out exactly where it was, thank you to PlayStationTrophies.org. You helped me find my final collectible and actually platinum my first game. Aww. Which was my game. But yeah, it was a fun experience. And being able to have that there, you know, again, it's, what does it really matter in the long run of having those trophies or not? But now, especially the idea of wanting to, one of the things that it has done for me is it's making me want to return to old games that I've maybe wanted to finish for one reason or another. Maybe games that I've wanted to replay again anyway, but just simply also, it gives me another incentive beyond just the replay value, which is cool. And I have that on my wall now.
And now, this week's meaty topic of discussion.
So, a few weeks ago, at the time of this recording, there's an article written by Max Schwerin, I'm hoping that I'm saying his name correctly, on Polygon, that's titled, Games Make Quitters of Us All, and That's Okay. And this is a topic that's been talked a lot about, like in development circles. There's been various GDC talks on this, various stats on how many gamers finish games, and what percentage completion do gamers typically even get through the narrative and things like that, as well as a lot of conversations on the fandom side of whether or not they finish games, how you can... who can necessarily have opinions on particular games because of how much they actually finished or not.
Well, and also what is finishing a game?
Exactly.
I mean, that's a big topic too.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, we talked about the idea of finishing versus completing a game not too many episodes ago.
Sure.
As probably more than you think, but...
Yeah. I'm old. Yeah. Well, everything was just the other day.
Everything's just a blur.
Well, actually, I mean, even the topic about achievements and things were largely about that.
Yes, there's a relationship there too.
Yeah, that's true.
But what I found particularly interesting about this particular take on it was not necessarily just the statistics of, oh, people don't finish games in the broad majority of most games.
And when you say finish, you mean actually see the end credits?
Yeah, that's probably the best way to put it. Yeah, for now.
Yeah.
In a story-based game or something like
that. As opposed to 100%, which no one does.
Yeah, which, right.
Well, or... There's other definitions of finishing too, though. So that's kind of what I think this topic
finishing
is about, right?
Finishing the single player game. Yeah.
And what we really mean here, when you say most people don't, you're talking about most people don't see the ending to the game, right?
Yes. Yeah. As far
I would normally
as
consider that
go.
Beating the game versus finishing the game. But I know it's like, it's a whole language thing, right? It's a language issue.
No,
because
very much so.
But you're saying they don't do either one.
Actually, yeah.
Well, but what do you mean either one? What is finishing a game?
Well, that's what we're trying
to decide. That's the subjective one, I think.
Yeah, that's what we're trying to figure out.
That's what I feel like this whole topic kind of is.
Right. But what I find cool about it, though, is and largely what this article is about and what I thought could be an interesting like kind of springboard into a discussion for us is that, you know, the second half of his argument being that it's totally okay. And thinking back on just kind of the way that we all discuss games and any of us who have friends who play games, how many games any of us have actually finished, and yet also still the fact that you can not finish or complete or beat a game and still feel like you played the game, not in the same way that you would say that you've seen a movie if you hadn't seen most of the movie.
I walked out in the last 15 minutes, but I saw that movie.
Right, exactly. You couldn't do that with
it. But in some sense, though, you did see that movie.
Well, you saw some of that.
You
movie.
Didn't see the whole movie, but you saw the movie.
But you didn't see the movie as intended. And that's a linear format.
Did you play the game as intended? If you, like, how much do you have to experience in the game to
and
say
my
you played
argument
it as intended?
There would actually be yes.
Because who's intending?
Yeah, that's a great point.
What do you mean yes, though? So if I play for 5 minutes at, say, Best Buy on a demo, I've now played the game as intended?
I think that's a little extreme.
Well, but you didn't specify. That's why I'm asking. So, like, what's the...
I mean, I think you can say you tried the game.
Yeah, sure.
No, absolutely.
Sure, but that's kind of my point. Well, it's like, I think that it's going to be really tough to talk about that. I think it's going to be really tough to talk about this topic because games are... And when I say games, I don't mean games from other media. I mean games themselves between other games compared to other games are very different. So someone... I know before we started, you started talking about Sonic the Hedgehog 2, right?
Sure.
And another game that we talked a little bit about was Grand Theft Auto 5. Mm-hmm. These are two very different games. And I mean by what the game expects of you, how much content there is, how many hours there are total versus how many hours it might take to complete it if you already know how to play it. Mm-hmm. All the optional content that is in Grand Theft Auto 5, when in Sonic 2, there really isn't optional content. I mean, for the most part, it's mostly just you have to beat all of these levels. It's not like GTA 5 where there's main missions and there's side missions. So they're two very different games. So to say...
And then there's mini games.
Right. So you can't just say when you say, okay, what does it mean to play? To say I've played Sonic 2 or I've played Grand Theft Auto 5. You're probably going to get different answers for both of those games. I don't think that there's one answer because they're so different. That's kind of what I'm getting at, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that at the core of the discussion of kind of how we introduced at the beginning and kind of where we want to go with this is the idea of because, and maybe that's not the case even at this table, but because I at least get the feeling that in most of the community, not necessarily completing, beating, finishing a game is a prerequisite to being able to discuss a game or feel like you have enough experience with the game to like cross that line of not having played versus played, whatever, however you define that. And because the grand majority of people don't ever reach the point of actually finishing, completing, beating the game, why do people then walk away from games? Why do we... So the concept of... I like the word incompleting games
right.
is very common in in our culture and very acceptable. Mm-hmm. And I think there's a lot of reasons for that in the way that games work as a form of entertainment, as a form of media, as well as maybe just simply in our just community and the way that we interact with them ourselves.
I think you kind of touched on two points there. And the first one was really more about the perception that other people have of how much content you've experienced of that game before you're able to give your opinion or talk about that game. And I think that's kind of it's sort of a different discussion, but I think it's all related. When it comes to that, I think really what people are looking for, and again, I think this is very, very much based on the individual game, but to me, it almost feels like a really personal thing. Like if you've played a game, if you feel like you've played enough of that game to talk about it intelligently, you're going to know. Like, and I'm not saying that some people will talk about a game without playing it that much and pretend like they do, but I think that those people, I mean, they're not even lying to themselves. They know what they're doing, right? Yeah. So I do feel that, particularly when you've played a lot of games and you're a pretty, you know, you're a seasoned gamer and, by the way, sometimes games surprise you. But for the most part, when you play a game and you get an understanding of its mechanics within a certain frame, depending on when it's introducing those mechanics, you start to realize, oh, I've understood all the mechanics in the game by now. Oh, in a lot of games, like, and Far Cry 5 is an example of which I'll talk more about next episode. I understand all the mechanics of those games, and I have for quite a while. I mean, I think maybe you can get in like maybe 5% of the content, perhaps, by the time you understand all the mechanics and you've tried all the weapons and you've tried all the different ways of trying to, you know, killing people. You've tried all the different vehicles. There's a lot of content there, but they kind of just throw everything else at you slap shot right from the start. Whereas if you compare it to, say, a game like Nier Automata kind of took a different approach where it would consistently try to surprise you with different mechanics in the game. So you would think and get really comfortable with one style, say, of combat, and then it would throw you for a loop and introduce like something totally different and expect you to learn something new that would be incorporated as part of the game going forward. So, and sometimes just intermittently going forward.
Actually, the reason why I didn't like that game.
Yeah, but but it was interesting that it did that, right? Because it's different, is part of it.
No, I mean, actually, it irritated me all to heck, and I really hated that game.
Sure. Well,
for the exact reasons why you loved it, and that's totally okay.
It's okay that you have wrong opinions, Doc.
No. What it means is that game was made for you. It was not made for me.
Well, like I said, when I say interesting, I'm not making a judgment of whether it's good or bad. I'm just saying that it is different, and it tried something new.
It was a risk, and I admire them for taking the risk. I personally did not like it, but then again, my style is to master a particular area, 100% that area, and then move on to the next area, which is exactly why I've never finished Witcher 3. Yeah. I get to Skellige and I abandon that game because I already completed the Triss Merigold storyline, and I was deeply uncomfortable with where it was going with Yennefer at that point. Mm-hmm. And I was like, no, I'm good. I think that Ciri's a big girl and she can handle herself.
Witcher 3.
And I had no narrative reason to continue.
Witcher 3 is an interesting example for this topic, I think, because it's... Now, I know some of us love the game. Some of us don't like the game. I've played well over 100 hours. Doc, I know you've put lots of time into it as well.
I restarted it so that I could... do it right. And then I quit at the exact same point,
right?
Meant for me that there was something deeply wrong about the narrative structure of that game for me.
I think it changes at a certain point and you have to kind of accept that and push a little bit more past when you get to Skellige, in my opinion, just to kind of to understand what the new area kind of brings.
Yeah.
And if you do, I feel like there's a lot more that it offers. However,
I'm sure that's true.
It does expect you to... go along with it, kind of go along for the ride. And I kind of experienced something a little similar. Where I was kind of like, I don't know if I really want to do this. And so I kind of pushed myself a little bit to get past it. Mm-hmm. And then when I did, I'm glad I did. But yeah, I totally get where you're coming from. My point on that is not to make a judgment on why people might quit Witcher 3. And I did actually, I beat Witcher 3. I got all the way through it. I haven't played every mission, but I've played almost every mission. So I've done... I loved the game. I thought it was an excellent game. But in terms of talking about it, I mean, we're talking about a massive game. There's tons of content in this game. There's tons of, in terms of the mechanics, it's not even just about the combat, although combat is a big part of the game. It's about exploration. It's about discovery. It's about the storyline. It's about developing your character.
Yeah, but you didn't like it, right?
Absolutely not.
Right, right. But you've also only played 2 hours.
And yet, actually, I think that I... because of a lot of what we're talking about, because developers know this as well, you develop a game so that you want to, because within those first few hours, that is typically when the mass majority your player base will drop off.
That's right.
And so when we talk about the level of, have I reached that line of saying I have played Witcher 3 versus not? Mm-hmm. For me personally, I have not. And yet I've played enough of it to know pretty much what that game is.
And know that you don't want to.
Exactly. And know that right. I don't necessarily want to get further into that line. Because if I say, yes, I've played Witcher 3, then people say, okay, cool. What do you think of the story? It's like, no, I did not get that far.
Yeah.
But I feel like I've experienced everything else.
You tried it.
I think that's where the try comes in. I feel like because it's so massive, and I think a lot of games are like this now in terms of content, you've put in a couple of hours, and I feel like that's enough for you to understand the mechanics of the game, the sort of game that it is, how it's going to play, and you understand, okay, while there might be more story and more content and more whatever, it's going to be along these lines.
Yep.
So if you're not enjoying yourself within that period and you feel like you already understand the game, I should put it that way.
Yeah.
You feel like you understand the game, you may not have experienced enough of it to comment about certain parts of it, particularly the story, but also certain missions. Like there's tons of missions that you've completely missed that, you know, are not necessarily story related, like in terms of what you might talk about. Right.
Right.
But you understand the game enough to know this really isn't my cup of tea.
Yeah.
So you understand the game.
And at its core, I feel like I can say, like, especially if I were to use it as a design reference for combat or something like that, I feel like I have played enough to be able to say, okay, yeah, Witcher 3 did this. It did a few things interesting there. We can copy that into a different design, or we can adapt that in different ways.
Sure.
Because enough of the mechanics, because enough of the game design and the core loop has been expressed to me.
I used to do that as a games professor just by watching videos.
Yeah.
So there was no way I could play all the games that were out there. So I would hit a couple of hours worth of games I thought were in the general area, pick the example I wanted, show 5 minutes of that content to the class, and then be like, okay, so how many of you have played this? Tell me about the experience. And if it was more obscure, the better, because then we could talk about, like, what did you see? What did you hear? That's what I always used to say.
Do you think that would be like the equivalent of Cliff Notes?
Sure.
I
think it's beyond
sort of
that.
As an aside, but
I think perspective.
Hold on. I mean, I don't mean you playing the 2 hours. Okay, I mean, Doc watching a video.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. Fair
which
enough.
Is, yeah, yeah. No. You definitely played the game.
Yeah. The point is to hit the highlights. Actually, what I would seek whenever I could would be like a game dev playthrough with commentary. Mm-hmm. If I could find that, then I knew.
Kind of like an E3 walkthrough sort of thing.
Yeah. Or like a dev diary.
Oh, I enjoyed some of the dev diaries for Skyrim more than I did the actual game. I found it really interesting, really some of the stuff that they did that they would talk about of that game. Actually, Skyrim's a great example for this too, because I assume everybody at this table has played Skyrim.
Yeah,
about as much as I did of The Witcher.
Okay.
I abandoned that game too, by the way.
I mean, as did I.
I played hundreds of hours in that game.
I did too. That's kind of what I wanted to bring up. I played probably about 100 hours, around 100 hours. Doc, probably similar, right?
Yeah, actually more like 200.
Yeah.
Because I restarted that game.
Right. Neither of us have beaten the game. In terms of seeing the end credits, right?
But meanwhile, I played like 30, saw the end credits,
there you
and
go.
Then walked away.
There you go.
That's hilarious.
But you also focused on, I'm assuming, you just went straight main storyline.
For the most part.
In order to get through with it.
A few side
time.
Tangents, but for the most part, yeah.
Because I wasn't interested in the main story, and so I just avoided it. And one of my issues with that game, I mean, I understand why you quit, by the way, because frankly, the atmosphere had left a lot to be desired. But one of the reasons why I think people quit games, particularly nowadays, I feel like it's because we have so many options now. When I was younger growing up, not only did we have maybe it was perspective too. I don't know. But I'm just gonna talk from my experience, so y'all let me know what from your experience as well. I didn't get that many games, you know, in terms of like I got games for special occasions or when I was able to like scrounge up enough from like allowance and mowing lawns in order to buy a game. So I didn't get a lot of games. So when I got a game, one, I had to be a little more careful about which games I picked up. So I had to be like, I needed to know this was a game that I'm going to be able to play for a while. And two, even if the game wasn't that great, I'm probably going to play all the way through it or at least try to, because I don't have that many options, right? That's kind of what I'm getting at.
That really makes sense, your perspective on finishing games even today.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But nowadays, I pick up games all the time because mm-hmm. I work a full-time job. I make money and games are more, they're out there. They're all over the place, mm-hmm. right? And so, and I do feel like we're getting a lot of games, but also we're getting a lot of games that are massive. Like back, you know, when I was playing games, we had some big games, right? But our example of a big game back in the day was like Final Fantasy I, Legend of Zelda. You know, these were the outliers on the NES, right? These were the outliers in terms of content. Most of those games were, including games that are very highly regarded, like, you know, Mario Brothers or something like that. You can beat that game if you know what you're doing
sure.
in a couple of hours. And I used to do that, or less. I used to do that in games that I knew how to play, or like Life Force, one of my favorite games on the NES. If you know what you're doing, and that game, by the way, is pretty hard. But if you know what you're doing, it's going to take you many, like, months and months and months to get good enough if you want to beat it legit, to actually go all the way through
that's
the game.
That's right. That's a completely different model, though.
Right. It is. But my point is that if you know what you're doing, you can get all the way through the game in a very short period. Whereas even if you know what you're doing in a game like, say, Grand Theft Auto 5 or The Witcher 3 or even Skyrim, it's still going to take you quite a while. You're not going to be able to sit down and play it in one sitting and beat it, even if you know exactly what you're doing because of the amount of content. So we're already talking about games that just have a lot more crammed into them. I feel like as we're older, we have more access. But, and I'm going to just throw this out there and I'll see what y'all think about this. I would say that for the most part, I do finish games, but I often don't beat games anymore, but I feel like I finish them.
So you're also talking about the difference between player ability and character ability. For yeah. example, you know, if you want to beat the game with Geralt, you've got to beat the game with Geralt.
True.
You can't beat the game as Jim. You know what I'm saying? You can't go in, like you just said, turn on the game and then just somehow crazily go straight through and beat the thing without leveling up your character and spending your character points.
Right.
You have to do that. That's part of the game.
Yeah, it's not just about player skill. It's also about the skills of that character.
Right.
Even to strip the story away, but that is a part of it as well.
Yeah, that would be like doing Fallout and then never spending any of your character points to get perks.
Mm-hmm. But there's still the story in Fallout 2. Like, if you really want to beat it, you have to go through certain story missions in terms of, and I'm talking
also
about
true.
To see the end credits.
Yeah, and I think that one of the interesting elements of this is the concept of what makes a game, and that is, like, when we're talking about arcade games and, like, the early platformers and things like that, mm-hmm. It's just, here are the mechanics, here are levels with increasing difficulty, get to the end, and dominate each one of those levels, right?
Or not even get to the end. I mean, especially you go early enough in the arcades, it was just just trying to get a high score.
Yeah, exactly.
Just go until you die.
Right. And then as games have gotten more complex and complicated through the years, and we have our GTA 5s now, mm-hmm. of which we have this element of narrative that we're trying to toss into game along with it. Now that's when we're having this discussion on quote unquote finishing a game or completing a game, seeing those end credits, not because of necessarily player ability, not necessarily because of increased challenge, but just because there's a story that you have to experience.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And I feel like part of the reason that you can walk away from a game and feel that you have still played it even today is because at its core, what the game still is are those core loops. The simple loops of just simply doing one thing, the longer loop of completing an entire mission or something like that, or completing a series of missions and then locking out that quest line or completing that quest mm-hmm. line. But that is what the game is. Actually seeing what Franklin does after 30 hours of playing GTA 5 is not really what the game actually is.
No, you're right.
Yeah.
I mean, it's true.
Yeah.
Well said.
I would compare that actually to, we were talking earlier about Sonic 2. And mm-hmm. like you said, you never beat Sonic 2. Actually, I'm in the same boat.
Uh-oh,
I can't
quite
beat that game.
Sonic
but,
talk.
But we both played Sonic 2. We played it a lot. We played a lot of Sonic 2, even though we never beat it. Mm. And so it's not even like we tried Sonic 2. We played Sonic 2.
Right.
And yet, you know, we can say that, like, to that point of the core loop, you might not have experienced a few little sort of like level specific mechanics. But for the most part, you know what getting through a level is in Sonic. Mm-hmm. In the same way, GTA 5, like, you could probably call something a level, a mission, a whatever. And like, even if you've, say, experienced all different types of missions, you can say that you understand at least this core loop or that core loop or something.
And with GTA 5, I'm glad you brought that up, because I feel like there are mission types, right, in GTA 5. And once you've played all those mission types, then it's really just a variation on a theme as you go through the game. And I do feel that Rockstar does a really good job of introducing variation as you go so that you don't burn out like right away. They don't just throw all the mission types at you right off the bat. Mm-hmm, that's within true. The first few hours. They do try to sort of gate them so that you have to get a certain point in before you get this other, like, you know, now you can do these sort of driving missions, and now you can do these sort of flying missions, or now you can do this kind of like mission with a teammate or what have you, or like with a couple of other characters as you switch off to do the heist and things like that. So they do try to throw in that variety, but there's only, when you boil it down, there's maybe like, I don't know if I can ballpark it, but like what, 7-8 mission types, something like that. But how many missions are there in that game?
Right.
Like 100?
Yeah.
I mean, there's a ton.
And yet what they're actually doing with that is, and I'm really glad that you brought that up, is they're introducing over time new takes on essentially the experience of what it is to play the game, mm-hmm. to actually just simply decrease boredom however many missions they're actually giving
or
you.
Or increase again, novelty is another way to say it.
That's what I would say,
flow
too.
Theory.
Yes, exactly. Because, you know, we can say that when we were young, we played a lot of Sonic 2, mm-hmm. but if they do introduce a few kind of unique elements as you get a little bit deeper in, mm-hmm. As you get to like the oil slick level, and you have the elements of, there are certain routes that you can't go back up because mm-hmm. of the oil. Or then when you get into the level where you're on Tails' plane, mm-hmm. you know, for years, because I was too young, I was never able to get that deep into the game. And so it wasn't until I was older that I actually recognized, oh, this is a new unique mechanic that mm-hmm. they're actually adding to the game, mm-hmm. and a new unique element. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that, Jim, you had brought up earlier, to kind of backtrack a little bit, in these design decisions, I actually argue that, like, that's not necessarily, it's a good decision on Rockstar's part to do that over time, because again, it's keeping players invested and interested in the game. But at the same time, there's also, if you want to know that people have experienced your game, if you have essentially that 2 to 3 hours with that player, it's incredibly important to introduce all of those ideas immediately. There's been a number of different talks, like GDC talks or things like that, where designers talk about the fact that the first mission, the first hour, the first maybe 2 hours of your game, especially for a AAA game, are the most important. And it's part of the reason that a lot of times game endings, quote unquote, flop, or aren't really necessarily as well thought out, or the level design isn't as good. It's because they literally focus more time on the beginning.
Oh, yes.
Just because with statistics, it's if 10 to 20% of your players will actually get past like the first like 30 or the first like 3 hours of your game. Of course, you want to focus on the part that most of all 100% of your players are actually going to do. If you actually get to that 30% mark, mm-hmm. that's actually incredible. Yeah. And that means it's like one of the best games ever made.
I feel like I think that kind of ties into what I was saying before about
Yakuza. That I was going to bring up is because Doc said that he didn't necessarily like Nier. And one of the things that they had brought up over time that you had brought up is that, and I haven't played it, but is that they introduce new ideas the deeper in that you get. And it might have helped Doc if he had just gotten all the mechanics at the beginning.
Maybe, but I feel like it might have helped him, but I feel like the game itself.
Oh, no, absolutely.
It approached this on, like, there's a lot of, and I don't want to get too far off into
this topic. It took a lot of chances
topic.
With that
yes,
game.
I feel like I would make the argument that, you know, there's a lot of talk about our game's art, our game's not art, etc. And I would say that just like with film, just like with books, some are, some aren't, mm-hmm. right? And I feel like Nier Automata was art, whether you like it or not. That doesn't mean anything, because saying something is art is not a statement of quality, right? I feel like because it took all these chances, and there was a reason why it took all these chances, it wasn't just, we're just throwing this stuff out there and see what sticks. No, there was real thought that went behind it, and it all played into not just the storyline, but the messages and themes of the game. So whether you like it or not, it's really immature.
It's a good design decision,
right.
But nonetheless.
And I completely agree with you, and I do agree that I think it would have been more accessible totally if they had done that at the start, and that I do feel like, you would probably have liked it more, but it would have, of course, the game that they designed, that they wanted to design. And of course, in doing so, they alienated some people that from being able to play their game or enjoy their game.
Honestly, it wouldn't have helped. It was a rail shooter, and I really can't get into rail shooters, and then it just got more esoteric from there. I mean, it wasn't my game. It wasn't for me.
Sure. Yeah. And that's fine. And there's plenty of games aren't. And I feel
to your point about it being an art game, actually, the fact that they jump around between so many of them, each of those game types and game styles is generally drawn from some already pre-existing thing. And so because this game is kind of a commentary on games, it's kind of counting on the audience having that background knowledge. Yes. And so it was designed for people that it's trying to speak to the people it's trying to speak to. Yeah. As redundant as that sounds.
I'm an explorer game type. And so when I don't have control over the direction I'm supposed to go next, I start losing interest very, very quickly.
Yeah.
And that's just universal.
Yeah, and it totally wasn't. I could totally see why you wouldn't like the game. Yeah.
But what this is reminding me of actually is the idea of getting kind of all your core mechanics out there as quickly as possible, giving people as many experiences as you can. It sounds like that first 2-3 hours is kind of the equivalent of the first episode of a TV show or the first chapter of
the
a
pilot.
Book. Well, because basically in that time you have to establish, like, you can't tell your entire story in that time, obviously.
Well, it's the hook. You're talking about the hook.
It's the hook, but what it also is a term that I really like from the podcast Writing Excuses is making promises to your reader.
Yes.
In this case.
Oh, yes.
Basically what you're doing is you're establishing for people, here's what you can expect from the story, here are the promises I'm making. And if you don't, like, sometimes you make a promise they don't end up keeping, that can be frustrating. Or sometimes you don't give people an idea that, like, hey, this thing is coming, so they don't get to that good part, that sort of thing.
Right.
And so what people basically get to see is, like, ooh, I'm on board with this because I can see where this is going or where this could go. And whether or not they're intrigued by that's going to decide whether they keep going with it. Mm-hmm. And so I think that you can kind of play those first 2 or 3 hours to determine that I'm not into this game. The promises this game is making are not ones that I'm interested in and experiencing.
So what I find, what I like a lot about, and that, I think that's a great commentary, but I kind of want to talk a little bit about that first couple hours and just sort of when that may have come about. And I know that people are talking about it now, and I completely agree with you. It's true now. But think about older games, not even just console games, but arcade games as well. I mean, you're talking about in the arcade, I'm sure they were having those similar type of ideas about trying to, hook players because they're trying to get people to literally throw in more quarters.
Oh, they got to do it in seconds or minutes.
Right. Yeah. Right. So that time is extremely shortened to essentially do the same thing.
Also, they're teaching you the mechanics more than anything else in those games.
Yes. The story isn't getting in the way of
that. Yeah, the story is incidental.
Yep.
Right. So, but yeah, I kind of wanted, just looking at that in terms of how things have changed when we go from the experience of, I'm going to teach you all the mechanics right off the bat, and you're going to understand whether you want to keep sticking in more quarters or not within the first, like, couple of minutes of play versus now it's become couple of hours of play. Mm-hmm. I just find that very interesting, kind of where we've come from. And in terms of, like, I think it goes into what does it mean to feel like you've experienced a game enough to talk intelligently about it? Mm-hmm. Like, say, Pac-Man, for instance. How long would you have to play Pac-Man to feel like you can intelligently talk about it? Because you can't really beat Pac-Man. I mean, the way you beat it is to get to, like, what is it, level 255 kill screen. Yeah. But very, very few people can actually do that. And nobody would really say, you can't talk about Pac-Man until you get to the kill screen. Because that's really difficult
to
do.
I also think, too, that it depends on what you're trying to talk about. So,
yes,
anyone can always talk about their own experience.
Well, sure. I mean, say something intelligent about Pac-Man, right?
Well, I could say something intelligent about, I died after 3 seconds of playing Pac-Man. And, maybe, like, there's that's not a lot to talk about, but I can talk about that 3 seconds.
Well, let me put it this way then. How long do you feel like, just going with Pac-Man, I'm talking about that because it's probably one of the most, like, distilled mechanics games. Like, when you look at some of those old arcade games, it's just, in this case, you just have a joystick. You can just move up, down, left, right. That's it. Mm-hmm. That's all you can do in that game. Now, there's things that you can interact with in the game. That's the extent of your controls. Up, down, left, right. Right. So
10 minutes is my answer. However,
sure.
Big asterisk and proviso. Okay. And here's the asterisk and proviso. Sure. I'm assuming that this is a video game student, someone who is a historian, if you will.
Someone that's played games before?
In the historicity of video games. Okay.
I see.
So in other words, someone who maybe wants to be a game designer or a game academic. All right. They've never played Pac-Man. You put Pac-Man in front of them, preferably in a console, for about 10 minutes, let them experience it, and then you hand them a book. And the book is called The History of Pac-Man. I don't know if that's a thing or not.
I find it interesting.
And then they read the book.
I find it interesting you said preferably in a console, and as opposed to if you had the arcade, if the arcade was a choice.
I'm sorry. What I actually meant was preferably in an arcade. Oh, okay. You're absolutely correct.
Okay.
But if you don't have the arcade, then at least a joystick instead of like
joystick's
WASD.
Really what I was going for. Cabinet is what I was going for. Sure. The point is, the more realistic, the better.
Sure.
As opposed to on your phone,
like an authentic experience. Yeah, you mean like an authentic experience?
Yeah.
Right?
The more authentic, the better. Right. And I was going like, because you can play Pac-Man on like Messenger or something stupid.
Oh, yeah.
Right.
Oh yeah.
No, that
you could play it on Google Maps for a while.
That doesn't count. That's not what I'm talking. Oh,
so
funny.
You don't want to play the mobile version that's got tilt controls.
Exactly. No, what I'm saying is the more authentic, the better. And 10, 15, maybe 20 minutes, if you can get in the zone, the pack zone, then you've experienced it and you've got the adrenaline rush. That's great. If you can't, that's totally fine, but maybe you can still appreciate it. And then, like I said, I want to hand you a book. Maybe it's just a chapter from a textbook so you can read the history of Pac-Man and why it was so significant to the culture. Because Pac Fever was a real thing, and that's really what it was about, is the understanding of that it changed our culture and that we have Witcher 3 because of Pac-Man.
Yeah. I would say it could be shorter. It could be longer than that 10 to 15 minutes.
I agree.
It's very personal.
I would say 2 to 3 levels.
Oh, that's a good way to put it.
Just 2 to 3 levels. And I think there's actually still parallels to that first 2 to 3 hours that we're talking about as well.
I like that.
No, I think
that
part
I think
of
that's
the
very
reason
fair.
Is yeah. in the first level, you get a feeling for the controls and what the basic mechanics are. Mm-hmm. You can then get to how to overcome the challenges that the game is providing.
Yes.
So kind of those three core tenets. You get to the second level and then see what will the designers do to change things on me to increase the challenge, to let me know where you have control and what you need to improve and what you don't have control over. And that's really it. And really, you know, as we're talking about games getting longer or anything, that first 2 to 3 levels is essentially what happens in that first 2 to 3 hours, however long those quests are, because of cutscenes and things like that. But it's really still just hitting those core tenets.
Sure.
And that's what I've experienced in, like, say, going back to The Witcher. That's what I've experienced is those first 2 to 3 levels. I have seen what the game is. I know how it feels. And I know what the designers are going to do over time. I know what that game is.
So let me ask you this about that experience in those first 2 levels. I know some people would pick up on this maybe within those first 2 levels if they were a seasoned gamer, but I would argue most people would not. How long do you think someone would, or do you think it's important, let me put it that way, for a player to understand that the ghosts in Pac-Man follow certain rules in terms of how they chase you? Because unless someone tells you, you're not going to learn that unless you play quite a bit of Pac-Man.
No,
I think you have to play it with intention.
Yeah.
Because
right.
I could play a lot of Pac-Man. It took me years before
precisely.
I even learned that
precisely.
They had specific patterns.
So that's kind of what I'm asking, though. It's like that would be something that hardened Pac-Man players probably know, but a lot of people that play it wouldn't, even if they've played several hours of Pac-Man, they may not pick up on that. And so the reason I bring that up is like, that's sort of like it's like learning how to game the system.
Well, exactly. And that's not incredibly important.
And no. I'm asking for bigger games. Oh, you're just saying just in general, it's just not really an important thing.
It does play into and kind of like to put another way what we said before, like not getting fun. We're changing it up to keep things from not being boring. But like, you know, fun is the process of learning new things and mastering a system.
Completely.
And so as long as there is something that you've not mastered, the game has the potential to still be fun. And that's one of the reasons that we do keep throwing in these variations and these new twists.
Yeah. A little bit of chaos.
And so I would say that, for example, the idea of like playing lots of Pac-Man until you understand that sort of stuff, that's kind of like demystifying in a way.
Yeah.
And at that point, once you sort of fully understand all the systems and can break them down, one, I think it very much changes the experience.
Oh, it does.
But then you're Wade Watson, you can get the quarter off of the top. Mm-hmm. Ready Player One reference there.
Yeah. But
once you've cracked Pac-Man, it's no longer fun. Mm-hmm. Or maybe it's a different kind of fun.
It's a different kind because you're trying to get as far as you can.
Yeah,
right?
you have to set a challenge for yourself, that sort of thing.
Yeah. But that's why they introduced in Ms. Pac-Man, which was very similar, only had slightly different mazes, the idea of having randomization to the ghost, which is why many people, including myself, feel that it's a superior game because it gave you more of that replayability. And by the way, they did the same thing with Centipede and Millipede. Same deal. There were patterns in Centipede that the really strong players, in order to get really far in the game, would memorize that you couldn't do in Millipede. And the whole reason, because of the randomization factor, and the whole reason they introduced it was not, it's in both Millipede and Ms. Pac-Man, was not because of some great design vision to give people more of a novel experience or anything. They weren't thinking about that. They were thinking of, how do I get more coins?
Mm-hmm. Of course.
Yeah. And people could argue too that that randomization, and like you could probably like really try to dig into it and understand how the randomization works if you're like really wanted to like kind of like crack this game, but also
you'd have to be a human computer.
Yeah. It was too complex for people to, like, you couldn't rely on just memory is what I'm getting at.
Yeah,
right?
And not just memory. And I think too that, you know, we talked before about randomization in games and how actually sometimes that can be taken as unfair. If a system is too random, then you have a hard time mastering the system. But it's like not even just, because there is that fine line between being discouraged that I can't learn the system and seeing that there is a level of mastery I can achieve and I just need to get there.
That's back to flow theory again.
And so like there are certain things where, like, say for instance, you randomize an environment, but like you, once you've sort of procedurally generated this environment, then you can learn at that environment for this playthrough of this roguelike or whatever the case might be.
So I would take this in a different direction to find a border zone, because I think we could talk about this forever unless we find a border zone. Here's a border zone that I propose. Okay. Everybody who has played a tabletop role-playing game, like for example, Dungeons and Dragons, knows that there is always a risk that the scenario will not be complete, that the party will dissolve and that the game night will stop. That's something that everybody who has done it for any period of time has experienced. And it's rough because then you have to abandon a character or something.
But not to sidetrack you too much, but this is also reminding me, like, we've talked a lot about quitting games. We haven't talked a lot about just kind of the games that you put down for the evening and just like never come back to for whatever reason.
Kind of fizzled out.
That's the kind of fizzle out effect. Yeah. I've got so many games I love that I want to finish that I just haven't gone around to yet.
Yeah. So that's kind of what I'm talking about here, except of course, from the very, very start, you have to understand what it is that goes into a tabletop role-playing game, which is that it's an open-ended system. Less so with something that is a pre-written scenario like D&D, which is why I mentioned it. More so with something that is a very narrative-driven system, well, like the stuff that Chris and I design at Doc and Kruger. And so what you end up doing at the end of that scenario or story or whatever is you wrap it up, the characters have their conclusions, and you go, wow, that was a really fun story and we finished it. And you never really feel like there's an unresolved issue or part or something you didn't play, unless there's some sort of character element that was unresolved. You know what I'm saying?
Some like loose end you didn't tie up. But like it's the same thing with any story. That, like, if you don't put a bun on everything, there's going
to
be some ambiguity.
But there's no way to, quote, 100% a tabletop game. It is limited to the experience you have while you're playing that scenario. Now, if you wanted to rerun the scenario with different characters in a D&D campaign, you could do that and maybe discover some new corners that you didn't poke into before. But that's kind of a different thing. So what we're talking about here with a video game is it's a closed system. There's a finite, it may be a huge number, but there's a finite amount of content in that disc. It's like the joke of you know, cracking it over your knee whenever you're done, when you 100% it, because frankly, what you've got in that experience of a video game experience is that there's the potential to do everything that you could possibly do. And at some point, you know, before that, you're going to see the credits. And at some point before that, you're going to decide, I'm done playing this game. And at some point before that, you're saying, oh, you know what? I feel confident that I've played this game enough to be able to talk about it, but I want to keep going. And at some point before that, you've tried the game and you may or may not want to keep going. So I think we've really delineated sort of four stages of gaming.
Yeah.
And to put it into reverse, you try it, then you play it, then you finish it, then you beat it. Or maybe it's you try it, you play it, you beat it, then you finish it. You know what I'm saying?
Or complete it, or
whatever word you want to use.
100% it or something.
Yeah, whatever.
Right. Yeah, and I think that one of the core, you know, kind of elements to like this discussion is the, especially when we tie that concept into a game of, I love that role-playing kind of analogy.
Because it tells us what it isn't.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. In that even, and that's why even in narrative-centric games, that almost essentially exist just simply to play the narrative. As somebody like as
Detroit,
a player,
which just came out.
Sure, yeah. As a player who is, especially when I was younger, like largely plays games for the narrative, and as
do.
A very big fan of JRPGs,
there
is a very, very, very long period of time that I never finished a JRPG in my life. And a part of that was because at some point, the game changes from what it was before. At some point in it, especially the Square Enix games, you'll probably know this, Jim, there's a moment in which the game opens up and you now know this is now the grinding time. You have essentially experienced everything in the game except for the climax. You have some side stories that you could possibly do, but
you're
for the
entrenched
most part,
in the narrative
you're now
point.
Just simply, the narrative is holding back.
I would say
we're just simply going to have you level for a while and then go beat the boss. And it's at that moment that Eric,
a journey tale.
Even today, says, no, I'm done.
I would say that's more of like the open period where you're able to explore and do additional content sometimes in different
orders. But the
game
inherently changes at that moment.
That's true.
And
I just wouldn't use the word. The word grind has a very specific meaning. Well, but in RPGs in particular, it has a very specific meaning where you might be thinking of grind as in you need to experience lots of content in order to get high enough level in order to beat the boss. But grind can also mean you're literally just fighting battles and doing nothing but going back and forth and fighting like the same battles to get XP.
Yeah.
Those are two kind of different things. No, they are different things, right? Like when you say open up, do you mean like
I think they're entwined. I really do. I'm with Eric on this one.
Yeah. Well, do you mean like in Final Fantasy VII? Like in Final Fantasy VII when you step out of Midgard, right?
Yeah.
And you have your is that what you're talking about?
No, I'm talking about the end of the game.
So yeah, you're talking about the pre-boss, like the pre-final boss where like after you've beaten the boss.
In Final Fantasy X, you finally get the airship.
Yeah. You load the game back up again and it puts you at that point right before the final boss.
Yes.
Yeah.
At the risk of introducing a topic.
Okay, I thought you meant before like okay, I thought you meant after the linear part where the game opens up. Never mind.
Well,
okay,
actually, I've had issues with that part, too, of like when Final Fantasy VII first opened up, I was kind of like, okay.
Yeah, that's why I brought it up. Yeah,
Final Fantasy VIII.
You know, that's immediately what I thought of with VII. Okay, so at the risk of bringing up a topic that could be its own topic, okay?
That's fine.
This is a cousin to what you were just talking about, and it's the MMORPG. Let's talk about WoW, because I think we've probably all played it. And that opening first couple of hours of WoW is very, very curated. It's very, very designed. And then you finish that little story arc. And just about any MMO is going to do that. And then it sets you free, like you're talking about. And at that point, it's pretty much understood that the design of the game at that point is to keep you playing and paying.
Yeah.
And that the idea of finishing or beating or leveling fully a character is something that most people are not going to do. And I think that that's a completely different game design. And whenever you finally do walk away from an MMO, or WoW. I don't think anybody faults you if you're walking away and you don't have a level 80 character or haven't beaten the final boss if there is one or, you know, whatever. So the new DLC comes out, you try it for a month or so and you're like, oh, I'm good. And you walk away. It's a different type of game.
Would you say that MMOs are the closest to an open system, like a tabletop game? And the reason I say that is because even though if you nail it down to like one particular moment, there's a limit in terms of what you can do. With an MMO, they're consistently updating and adding new content.
I think it's as close as we can get. And as soon as you add the
I'm not saying
human
the same.
Interaction element,
that
the
well,
rating
yes.
changes. You've seen the back of the box. Mm-hmm. It says rating changes on online play, right?
Yeah, I've been meaning to apologize for that.
But I mean, when we read about some of the stories that have happened about, you know, deaths that have been honored in an MMO space through a funeral or
weddings.
Weddings that have occurred in an MMO space or you know, actual protests and raids and things like that. It's very interesting what can happen in those kinds of spaces. And that's not something you're ever going to get in, you know, Fortnite and PUBG, man. You're just not.
No.
Yeah.
It's a completely different culture.
Watch me.
But to go to an MMO, so let's kind of look at that and examine it in this same sort of perspective, because it might take you a couple of hours to get through that first story arc that you're referring to, Doc.
The opening element.
But in terms of if you really want to be able to dig deep into it and talk about WoW and have an informed opinion about all of the things that are related to it, you're not going to be able to talk about, say, you know, instances and dungeons. You're not going to be able to talk about raiding, for example, right?
Yeah.
I mean, you can. I'm not saying that you can't. You haven't experienced part of the game, right? But there's a whole bunch of content that you haven't experienced that you may not be able to even talk about yet because it's so early in the game.
Yeah, I actually even argue that there's going to be players who, especially if we talk about a game like WoW or like Destiny, these new games as services, in which there's so many different modes and experiences that somebody can have. You're not really going to ever meet a person who can talk about everything that the game offers. In that, like, even if we just look at WoW, we can have somebody like me who I've never actually had a max level character, but I have played many, many characters through the years. So I feel like I've played WoW. To my friends who had raid groups and actually ran, you know, huge raid groups and like kind of did all of that. There's parts of the games that they've never experienced because they've never done high level PvP. High level arena players who never did raids, but did high level arena and even did it professionally and competitively.
And there's something about like the experience of being someone who is in that click, if you want to call it that,
right,
of like, this is the way that I'm playing this game. Another comparison I would draw is actually Overwatch, where I've played like every map, pretty much every character, at least a little bit, every mode. And yet I can't talk about what it's like to be a diamond level player or a grandmaster level player, because that's just completely outside of my experience. And they're very different experiences. The way that are played, the way that people communicate, like I can say that I've played a lot of Overwatch. I haven't played that way.
Is that not the same sort of, because I think we're talking about two different things. Like when you're talking, please correct me if I'm wrong, because I haven't played much Overwatch at all. Aren't you kind of comparing the casual player experience to the professional, like someone playing, say, you know, basketball on the street with some friends versus like in the NBA, as opposed to what Eric is talking about with high level PvP versus raids? These are two very different experiences.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. And I'm just saying that like, this is like one other way in which we're experiencing a different game, quote unquote, despite the fact that it's the same game.
Even just if we go back to WoW, role playing servers versus, a PvP server.
You can have a very, or at least you should have a very different experience.
Yeah, exactly. Which, speaking of Fortnite, that would be amazing if there was role play Fortnite somewhere out there.
That would be interesting. Yeah. That actually might make me want to play Fortnite.
I actually have to imagine there has to be some community out there that's organized.
I mean,
that,
just use Fortnite, like a round of Fortnite as your conflict resolver and an RPG that you're running, and there you go.
Oh, actually, yeah. I was thinking more like a corporate HR team putting that together, like if there's a conflict or like... but that's actually kind of amazing as well, is if there's conflict in a tabletop.
The conflict resolution, like for disputes. Right,
yeah. I actually had a really fun campaign around runtime where we used custom characters in Soul Calibur 5. And we actually had an element of like you unlocked like newer and better gear as you went along, that sort of deal.
Yeah.
So that was a lot of fun. So thank you for joining us, everyone, for episode 130 of the Backward-Compatible.com podcast, our discussion on incompleting games and why and how and what it means and all this. Yeah. All this fun stuff.
So we're sort of leaving our discussion incomplete.
Indeed.
Yeah, I think we should just walk away from this at this point. Yeah. I'm not having fun anymore, it's just not fulfilling.
It's kind of fizzled out.
You know what? I'm kind of hungry. I'm going to go grab my hamburger.
Yeah. What I think we should do is plan to get back to this topic and then not.
There you go.
I like that.
Cool. Well, I'm Chris.
I'm Jim.
I'm Eric.
I'm Doc.
And we'll see.
We want you to write into the show because dialogue makes everyone better. If you want to comment on this episode, ask a question, share some info, voice an opinion, or request a topic, send an email to inbox@backward-compatible.com, and we may feature you on a future episode of the podcast. Thanks for listening. Until next time, stay compatible. Backward compatible.
We'll see what. Exactly. It's incomplete. I'm so confused right now.
Wow.
Okay.
Like a weird
interesting. Next level.